an.
So we'll cut to the chase. Yitzchak decides that it's time to pass on the mantle of the future leadership of the Jewish people. Who will be the one to serve as the progenitor? And obviously Yitzchak, who loves Esav, thinks Esau, he's the one. Rivka hears and she intervenes and does some very, very bold things to make sure that Yaakov is going to be the one to receive those blessings. And she essentially undercuts or usurps what Yitzchak is trying to do. And she dresses Yaakov up, disguises him as Esav, and she sends him in. In the narrative, we're going to take a look, it's going to pick up chapter 27, verse 20. Vayomer Yitzchak el bnei, Yitzchak says to his son, who's Yaakov, who he thinks is Esau, is Esav. He says to him, Ma zeh miharta limtzei bni. How'd you do it so fast? I sent you out to go trap animals and then slaughter them and make me the Korban Pesach, as the Medrash tells us. And here you are, you have a ready-made meal. Sure, Yaakov had his mother helping him. She took care of everything. She made the meal for him. But at any rate, he says, Ma zeh miharta, how'd you do it so fast? Vayomer, Yaakov says, oh, listen, it's in Hashem's hands. Ki hikra Hashem lefonai. God arranged everything before me. It's in God's hands. And the Radak says that there's more humility than you think. What happens here is Yaakov is saying it was your merit because you sent me on a mission. That's why things went so beautifully and so smoothly. Vayomer Yitzchak el Yankev. Yitzchak says to Yaakov Avinu, he says, Gisha na va'amushchabni. I need to feel you up a little bit because, of course, Yitzchak is blind. Ata zebni Esav imloi? Are you really Esav? And the reason that he's suddenly asking his Esav is because all of a sudden this son of his, this Esau, who he thinks, is talking about God, and he's being respectful, and the Esav doesn't talk like that. Now, obviously, they were identical twins. It's clear that they sounded exactly the same. If they didn't sound exactly the same, what would the question be? From the very fact that there's a question, we understand that they must have sounded exactly the same. Vayigash Yankev el Yitzchak, so Yankev leans in to Yitzchak, Aviv, Vayimushehu, and he started to feel him exactly as Yaakov had predicted. Vayomer, and he exclaimed, Hakol kol Yaakov, the voice is the voice of Jacob, Vayadayim yidei Esav, but the hands are hairy as Esau's. So in other words, the only difference in the two of them was that Esau was a hairy fellow and Yaakov was not. Otherwise, they had to be virtually identical, including the sound of their voice. And you're going to say to me, what do you mean? Clearly the sound of the voice is not the same because he's saying, Hakol kol Yaakov. Okay, let's take a look at Rashi. So Rashi says in verse 21, Gishono va'amushcha, says Rashi, Yitzchak began to be suspicious, not because the voice sounded different. There would be no suspicion then. It would be hands down. Who knows it's Yaakov. Omar Yitzchak Beliba, Yitzchak said in his heart, Ein derech Esav li yeshem shamayim shagur b'fiv. Esav doesn't talk about God. And this son is talking about God. V'zeh, Omar ki hikra Hashem lefanecha. So therefore, he says, he feels him up and he says, oh, feels like Esav. But Hakol kol Yaakov. Rashi again says, it doesn't mean the sound of his voice. For the sound of his voice, you need to feel him. And you would never be able to fool a blind man from the sound of the voice. You know somebody's voice. You know if they're there, if they're not there. How would that work? So Rashi says, Shemedaber b'loshayin tachnunim. He speaks with supplication. He speaks so respectfully. He says, Kumna, please, Dad, get up. Aval Esav, kintur yadibar. Esav was always spiteful and biting and a cynical sense of humor. Yaakov Avi, get up, pops. So it was a way different way of speaking. So Yaakov is like, he doesn't sound like Esav. They don't speak the same. Vayomer, and Yitzchak says incredulously, Ata zebni Esav? Is this really Esav? Yitzchak must have been delighted. Esav finally turned the corner. You see, he thought to himself, I was right. I just had to give him those blessings. I didn't even give the blessings yet. And he became a little chassid. Now he speaks like a mensch, and he's respectful, and he talks about God. And he's just amazed. So what does Yaakov say? Oni, I, or I am, but he never says I am Esav. Lo yamar ani Esav, Rashi says. He didn't say, I am Esav. Elo ani, he said, I am. He didn't say, why I am what? And Yaakov is very careful, even when he is using guile and deception to do what has to be done, because it was the right thing to do, he still didn't lie in an outright fashion. He was still careful to parse his words and carefully kind of say what had to be said without saying everything. Vayomer, so Yitzchak says, Hagisha li, draw close to me. Va'oichla mitzeid b'ni, let me eat from the trapping of my son, l'man tevorechecha nafshi, so that I might bless you. Vayigash lai, he leans in, and he brings him the food. Vayoichal, and he eats. Vayavi lo yayin, and he brings him wine. Vayesht, and he drinks. Vayomer elav Yitzchak, Yitzchak says to his son, Yitzchak aviv, Gishana, ushkal libni. He says, come close. Kiss me, my son. Why is he talking about getting, he's kissing him all of a sudden. So therefore, we clearly see there seems to still be a certain amount of suspicion. And now he wanted to not just feel Yaakov to see if he was Esau, but in fact, he wanted to smell him. And that is what the Bechor Shur, that's all he says it. He says, Yitzchak is still unsure. He says, there seems to be conflicting signs here. He sounds like Yaakov, he feels like Esav. He says, I'll make the decision, al pi hareach, based on the scent. Everybody has a scent. He says, I know Esav usually smells very nice. He used a lot of cologne. Let me smell Esav. Let me smell him. Omar lo, so he said, therefore he said to him, sheyishakeh, he said, kiss me. When he'll kiss him, he'll smell him. He'll smell his breath, he'll smell his clothes, he'll smell him. He smells like Esav or not. Va'az yuchal harichay, once he kisses him, he'll be very close. Once he's close, then he'll be able to smell him, he'll know. And this is going to be trouble, because Yaakov doesn't smell like Esav, not by a long shot, especially now wearing goat skins on him. He's like, he must have smelled horrible. But there's no choice. He said, lean in. So Vayigashla, he comes very close. Vayishakla, and he kisses him. And Hashem makes a miracle. Vayorech esreach begodav. He smells the scent of his clothing. And he says, wow, what a fragrant frock. Vayivarcheu, he blesses him. Vayomer, he says, Re'ei reach b'ni, see the scent of my son, k'reach sode asher berche Hashem, like the field that God has blessed. So Rashi says, what's up with the field? And how could he smell nice? Number one, haloi, after all, ein reach yes ra yeser mishetef ha'izim, there is nothing more offensive, no scent more offensive, no smell the opposite of fragrant. We call it a pungent smell, which doesn't necessarily mean a bad smell, by the way. It means a piercing smell. But there's no smell more pungent in a negative way than shetef izim, than the skins of goats. And that's what we should smell. So we see there must have been some kind of miracle take place here. Melamed shenichnasa imei reach gan Eden. Along with Yaakov came the scent of the Garden of Eden. And that's the meaning of k'reach sodah sheberche Hashem, says Rashi, shenosan boy reach toiv. That Hashem has placed in this field good scent, fragrance. V'zeh ostei tapuchim, this is the euphemistic field of apples, and smells the apples have this sweet smell. Kach dorshu rabbi seno, this is the way our rabbis expound it in Meseches Tainus on page 29. And so now everything in stage is set. In the sixth reading, we will see and hear of Yitzchak extend the blessings to Yaakov, thinking that it's Esav. So I want to share with you the words that the Sifri, in the end of the Torah, the Sifri, of course, is the Medrash Halacha that accompanies the last two books of the Torah, by Midbar and Dvarim. And in the Sifri, in the Zeis HaBracha, there is a remarkable statement that's made about this very verse, the field and its fragrance. And it certainly seems odd. And we'll see how the Rebbe explains it. So page Shin Nun Beis in the Biurim book. This is a quote from the Sifri in Zeis HaBracha. Melamed, this verse teaches us, Sherah Yitzchak as Beis HaMikdash Banoi v'charav v'banoi. Yitzchak Avinu had a vision of a Beis HaMikdash built, destroyed, and rebuilt. How do we see that? Re'ei reach b'ni, see the scent of my son. He said, see, re'ei, see. Harei banoi, this is the Beis HaMikdash built. K'meshir kosov, like it says about korbanot, about offerings. L'reach nichoyach, a fragrant and pleasing aroma. K'reach sodeh, like the fragrance or pungence of the field. Harei chorif, that's destroyed. K'meshir kosov, like it says, the prophet predicts, and in the end was fulfilled, tzioin sodeh techerosh, that Zion, meaning the Beis HaMikdash, became plowed up like a field. You couldn't even tell where the building once was.
Asher Berach Hashem, that was blessed by God. Hare Banoi, blessed by God, refers to the Beis HaMikdash, rebuilt. Meshuchla L'Asid Lavi, when it's all completely refurbished. And this, of course, refers to the future that is yet to come. So basically, the Sefri breaks up this pasuk into three segments. Re'ei Re'ach B'ni, Beis HaMikdash. Kireach Sode, destroyed Beis HaMikdash. Asher Berach Hashem, rebuilt Beis HaMikdash. So the Rebbe says, number one, what is the connection between Churban Beis HaMikdash, which is the opposite of anything that's good, the opposite of a blessing? What's the connection with Berachas Yitzchak? How does a destroyed Beis HaMikdash figure into blessings that Yitzchak's about to give? Number two, why is the destruction of the Beis HaMikdash alluded to in the word sada, field, specifically? Now, it's true, there's a verse that says, Tzion sada techerash. However, the Rebbe says, Adayin derish bir, madua nivchere dafka hamila sada. There are many words that describe a destroyed Beis HaMikdash. Tzion sada techerash incidentally happened decades after the Beis HaMikdash was destroyed. Literally decades later. It was not the immediate destruction of the Beis HaMikdash. It was a later assault on the Jewish people by Turnus Rufus, who was a later regent of Rome. So why do we use that, Kedei Levati, as Churban Beis HaMikdash, in order to discuss the destruction of the Beis HaMikdash? Why specifically that? V'habir b'zeh. The Rebbe gives us an incredible explanation. Lefi pshat ha-mikra, according to the simple way to understand these verses, who does Yitzchak think he's blessing now? Who? Esav. He's blessing Esav. Hare lefi machashavte Esav hu sha'amad lefanav. According to his idea, he thinks it's Esav standing in front of him. So what, if you were Yitzchak, what would you want to bless Esav with? Esav was a sinner. Esav was a terrible guy. He does bad things, but he's got potential. He's got potential to be good. But factually, he's not good right now. If you wanted to bless him, what would you bless him with? Kavanosis shel Yitzchak. The intention of Yitzchak was losersly es hakoyach lachzer merishoy, that he wanted to give him the strength, the spiritual fortitude and conviction to do tshuva, to come home, b'tshuva shleima. V'lochein gam lefi ha-metzias b'peil, even though this was Yaakov, but in fact, what was Yitzchak blessing him with? Sheyi is a Yaakov, it was Yaakov, but brachas unus nesenes es hakoyach la'avaydas, Hatshuva, the blessing that our ancestor Yaakov received, although Yitzchak thought he was giving it to Esav. But put that aside for a moment. The blessing is the blessing that we can always be the comeback kid. No matter where we stray, no matter where we roam, we could always come home. That's what Hashem is telling us. That's what the blessing Yitzchak is giving. What's the preface for all this? Ra Yitzchak es Beis HaMikdash b'churbanai. Yitzchak saw a Beis HaMikdash destroyed. What is that indicative of? A matzav shel yirida ruchnius ushfal hamadrega. This indicates a tremendous spiritual failing. Destruction. It refers or alludes to a very, very low level, a low ebb. Uberchasai. And therefore the blessing, noyed alasas is a koyach lehizgabit al matzav shofalzeh. It's a blessing that you should be able to bounce back even when there's a Beis HaMikdash that's so destroyed that there's absolutely nothing left, not even foundations. Nothing. It's a field. You don't even know where the Beis HaMikdash was when you look at it now. And nonetheless, we should be able to bounce back and rebuild. A new Beis HaMikdash should rise. And that's why the Rebbe suggests the emphasis is the word sada. Mashmo usay shel tshuva. The real deep meaning of tshuva is she'adam mevatzel es matzavei hakeidim, that a person can actually eliminate the previous set of circumstances. You were sinful, you were rebellious, you were bad, finished. A new reality. Like the Rambam says, ineni oisei ish, I'm not that person. A baal tshuva changes his name. New identity. Lahaschil lichis is chayev mechadash. It's like literally a new leaf. It's a new life. Bedagar nailas on a higher level. And this is the indication of what Churban Beis HaMikdash really is about. It's not negative. On a deeper level, Churban Beis HaMikdash amatara b'kach, the purpose of the destruction is kedei lahavi levinyane shol Beis HaMikdash mechadash. It's in order to bring us to a rebuilt Beis HaMikdash in a higher way. V'lochein, therefore, nirmes adav b'pasek tzin sod techrosh, not just a field, a plowed field. Mishum, because churban beis hamikdash achin daima l'charisha, it's like not just a field, but like a plowed field. Because the purpose of plowing up the field, which you're breaking the field, you break the crust. Seems like you're ruining the field. But the matara is levato matzava b'kaidim, to take the field out of its previous state, which it looked nice, a nice whole field, but a field that was growing nothing. A field that just produced straw. So you break up the previous situation, and you do this kadesha tehiruya, so that it'll be worthy l'zriyach hadasha. So HaKadosh Baruch Hu plows up the old Beis HaMikdash, destroys the Beis HaMikdash, but only that allows for the rebuilding of the third and eternal Beis HaMikdash. And that, my friends, was the bracha that Yitzchak Avinu ended up giving to Yaakov, and that is the blessing that every single member of Am Yisrael has, regardless of how low we fall, regardless of where we end up, we always have the ability to bounce back. And just like the Beis HaMikdash should be rebuilt in Meretz Hashem speedily and in our days, we all have the ability and the special gift of rebuilding our own Beis HaMikdash, despite the fact that we may have entered into a phase of destruction, and that can be only a catalyst for even greater growth. May it be speedily and in our days. Amen.